Tomoko Platen, and my talk is about freedom in the data center. So most computers in data centers use Intel and AMD hardware, and in both kinds there are many blobs, including the Intel management firmware since 2008, which includes the active management technology and many other security holes. And Libreboot was able to remove the management engine firmware on the GM45 architecture, but on newer architectures the management engine firmware cannot be removed. And on AMD processors there is a second RAM core on board, which is called the platform security processor, and that needs a blob to release the main CPU, the 86 core, from reset. So if you remove that blob, you won't even able to start the processor, and both those blobs are signed and cannot be replaced. Only on the older hardware supported by Libreboot, such as D16 board, there is no signage required, so it can run both Libreboot and OpenBMC. And most graphics cards need that signed blobs too, and on Intel the management engine is also used to implement DRM, and often the DDRM training is proprietary, and that had been reverse engineered by a Purism employee who also found out how the management engine works and that parts of it can be disabled. Now I present Coreboot, which is the free BIOS that the D16 and other machines use. Coreboot started as Linux BIOS in 1999, and it originally included a small kernel in the flash chip. And before you can run Linux, you need to initialize hardware. This includes DDR RAM training. Then you need to enumerate devices on the bus and so on. And once that is done, it runs a payload, which can be ZBIOS if you want to run any legacy operating system, or it can be grub or even petit boot, which is used on most modern systems. Coreboot completely runs in 32-bit protected mode, so unlike the classic BIOS, there is no 16-bit code, and it is therefore easier to maintain. And modern versions on modern hardware contains many blobs. There is the hardware enablement package for Intel, which really does everything. And once that's done, a payload can run, which is often the Theano core, or on some data centers, Linux boot is used. And porting a board is time consuming and expensive, so there are only a few useful boards which are 100% free, supported by core boot. And one of that is the D16, which Viking sells after Raptor Engineering ported that board. Then there is LibreBoot, that is a completely free distribution of core boot, not GNU Linux, and it only runs stable on older ThinkPads, and on the server there are some bugs, and if it uses grub, it also supports full disk encryption. It also runs on M-based Chromebook using Rockchip hardware, thanks to the work of Google, who ported core boot. And in most cases, ZBIOS or grub is used as a payload. Recently, a new build system was written by two LibreBoot contributors, Andrew Robbins and Paul Kay. I don't know this person's full name, or it's too long to speak. On many mainboards, there is a management firmware. On Intel, there is active management technology, which can be used to remotely power cycle PCs. It has a KVM feature, so it can remotely controlled using virtual keyboard, mouse, and screen, and this requires special hardware support. Some AMD systems use an A-Speed BMC, which runs a non-free software, and both systems contain backdoors. And now we want to remove those backdoors and use only free software on those systems. And this is possible on the first system, which can be used in freedom. Even using remote management is the D16. And that uses OpenBMC, which Raptor Engineering had ported 2 years ago. And the new Talos 2 system, a Power 9 based computer, also uses that OpenBMC. This is an example of such D16 mainboard. It has slots for 2 CPUs, and in this case only one is needed to boot the board. It has a management controller, and to run OpenBMC, you need to first buy a BMC module. Those are not easy to get, as this is a 5 years old system, and by default those mainboards are sold without a system, so I b- bought mine from an American vendor, paid using TransferWise after my credit card was declined, and finally after 3 weeks I got the module and I tried to flash OpenBMC on the module, but I didn't succeed. So probably the module is broken or there was some more missing information on Raptor's page. And I am unable to debug. Since I would have to solder on the mainboard, which Raptor Engineering did. So they connected a JTAG debugger, and in the first step, they ported the kernel Linux to the ASPEED, which has an ARM core. And after they got Linux running, they ported the rest of the user space components. And once all user space components are ported, one could use the system with the BMC. Shortly after the port, IBM had released the Power 9 processor to the general public, which is used in the Talos 2 and in many other systems. Unlike x86 systems, there is no non-free software required to operate the Talos 2, and by default, everything is free. The Talos 2 is a Power 9 Sforza-based dual socket mainboard, so there are different variants of the Power 9. It is available as both scale-up and scale-out, which can be used with different operating systems. In this case, we are running GNU Linux. I have Debian on my system. And unlike the Power 8, the Power 9, at least in the Sforza variant, does not use those Centaur chips, which are external memory buffers that are only used as for special applications in the data center. And it does not need a north bridge and a south bridge, since it has direct attached PCI Express. So one can directly attach an NVMe and doesn't need an external storage controller. But it is offered with an optional SAS controller, which has non-free firmware. The full boot firmware was released by IBM under the Apache license, and they also licensed their Maskwerk openly to member companies of the Open Power Foundation. So that member companies can customize the silicon and OpenBMC itself is developed by mainly IBM, since many IBM systems use that OpenBMC, and then there is the NIC chip from Broadcom. It has non-free firmware, but there is a reverse engineering effort. And it is likely that a free replacement firmware will be created so that one can operate the Talos 2 with OpenBMC in full freedom. And in this case, the network signal which goes to the BMC goes first to the NIC chip, which has two MAC addresses, one for the BMC and one for the main network connection, which goes to the power. So unlike the D16, you only need one network cable be plugged into the server to use the remote management function. Then I explain the open power firmware, what it does and how it is different from x86 firmware. First of all, here we have OpenBMC, which also controls the power rails. So the first step when you press the power button is that a GPIO on the BMC is signaled, and the BMC then controls the power rails, turns on power and sends the first command to the Power 9 processor, which then runs the self-boot engine. The self-boot engine then verifies the signature. If secure boot is enabled, it can be enabled by plugging a jumper. And the first program that runs on the CPU after being verified by the self-boot engine is host boot. Host boot initializes all the hardware and then loads a Linux kernel, which is all so stored in the flash chip. So in the first step, it initializes DRAM, the processor bus and memory buffers and everything Linux needs. It prepares a device tree, which is used on power systems instead of a CPI, and it also loads OPAL, the Open Power Abstraction Layer, and then a small user land will run on top of the Linux kernel, and that can load operating systems via KEXIC, and all those firmware components, both the BMC on one flash chip and the Open Power firmware are free. Also the software that runs on the system FPGA on the Talos 2 is free, and here even the toolchain used for the FPGA is free. And one vendor, Vikings, has promised that they Version Start Hosting on the Talos 2. Here is a photo of my Talos 2 system installing Debian. The system has two sockets, but only one socket is populated, and so I can only use two of those PCI Express slots. If I need more PCI Express slots, I will have to install a second Power9 CPU, which is available from 4 cores to 22 cores, and theoretically it should be possible to have 24 cores, but for yield reasons, the maximum number that are available is 22. And now I give you the chance to ask questions. I think so, yes.